What is the Homemaking for Dummies series? This is just a series where I give you a rundown on things that I believe all homemakers should know. If you are an aspiring homemaker and you still live at home, or if you are new to the homemaking game, or if you are a seasoned homemaker and you are just looking for some new tips or maybe some reminders, then this series is for you. Welcome back to Humble Homemaking. This is episode 4 of the Homemaking for Dummies series. If this is the first video that you clicked on, I will link the entire playlist for the series up above and down below. First, I want to say that the background has changed again because I took down my Christmas decorations. I think I should put a big mirror up or something on the wall to fill up space. I'm thinking a mirror. That's my big idea, but what do you think I should put on that wall back there? Because it is looking pretty naked and pretty sad. So, anyways, let's get started with today's episode. The first tip I have mentioned before in this video, this is don't forget to empty your lint trap. It can be so easy to forget about that lint trap, but try and do it after every single load, even if there's not a lot on there, because it is very dangerous. House fires can happen from dryer lint not being emptied regularly. Do it after every single load, even if there's just a little bit on there. Next tip, cleaning and disinfecting are two different things. Make sure you know the difference. For example, my coffee table. Cleaning off the coffee table where Atlas frequently eats his snacks would be to clean off the food crumbs, clean off the food residue or the drinks he may have spilled on there. And then disinfecting would be to take something and spray it down so that it's killing all the germs and bacteria so that nothing icky grows there. Another example would be light switches. So you're gonna clean off fingerprints off of light switches, then you're going to disinfect. I've mentioned this in a previous episode, but for cleaning things, I use vinegar. I use a vinegar and water mixture with some essential oils in it. That's for cleaning and degreasing. And then for disinfecting, what I use is a 70% isopropyl alcohol, and I also add essential oils to that. I prefer to use the Thieves oil essential oils because Thieves oil by itself is actually, that little blend is actually a disinfectant itself. So I like to add that to the alcohol and it makes the house smell like cloves and whatever else is in that mixture. But I like that smell. If you don't like that smell, maybe go with something like orange or lavender. Just make sure that you are doing both. Don't just clean something, disinfect something. Clean and disinfect. Clean first, then disinfect. The next tip is to make sure that for each room you are using different rags and towels. So obviously for the bathroom, you don't want to use your bath towel to clean something, right? So you want to have rags specifically for cleaning the bathroom, same for the kitchen and the living room. I am a pretty frugal homemaker. I've mentioned in this video before what I use to clean my bathroom. I like to use old t-shirts, cut them up, clean the outsides of the toilet, clean the sink surface off, and this just makes it so that I know not to mix old t-shirts because I know those clean the bathroom. I know not to mix those with the rest of my laundry or the rest of the rags because I don't want to mix the bathroom rags with the kitchen rags because that's pretty gross. And so I like to wash them separately. And then if I have to throw a rag away, it's an old t-shirt. It has gone through so much already. It's gone through wear and tear, and then it's gone through cleaning the bathroom. So it's best to just end its life and throw them away. And then for the kitchen, I use specific color microfiber cloths, yellow for the kitchen, and then I use blue microfiber cloths and old socks for the living room, for the windows and dusting and all that. Having rag colors or different types of rags for different rooms will make it easier on you when it comes to separating your laundry and making sure that you're not accidentally using a bathroom rag in your kitchen. Next tip is to never pour grease down your drain. So when you are cooking hamburgers or steaks, for example, and there's a lot of grease that is accumulated in the pan, you do not want to dump it down the sink. Just because it's liquid does not mean it's going to stay liquid in the drain. If you sit there and wait, you'll actually notice that it will solidify in the pan, and that's what will happen in your drain and will cause clogs, and nobody likes a drain clog. So the less Drano I can buy and have to use, the better. So what I do is I keep an old can or a jar on the side of my sink. When I'm cooking something with grease, such as hamburgers or steaks, I will pour the hot grease into the jar or the can, and then when it solidifies, I will just scrape it out into the trash. I have 100% assurity that nothing is going down the drain to solidify and clog my drains. This next tip is about vinegar again, because I love vinegar. It is so multi-purpose, but this one is using vinegar as a rinse aid in your dishwasher. Pretty much every dishwasher has a rinse aid compartment, so just pour the vinegar in there and use that as a rinse aid. Using vinegar as a rinse aid cleans off any potential residue that may have stuck on from your dishwasher detergent, and on top of that, it cleans your dishwasher. The next tip is make sure that you are checking your garbage disposal before turning it on. Make sure that you stick your hand down in there, you check to make sure that no forks or knives or spoons got stuck down there, or if you have children, making sure that none of their little baby spoons or bottle nipples got stuck down there, because turning on the garbage disposal will just take those things to shreds. So make sure that you're checking them, and not to mention it's pretty scary when a spoon gets stuck in there and you turn it on. I don't have the privilege of having a garbage disposal, so I don't have to worry about that. I do know from past experience that growing up in a house with a garbage disposal and then living in other houses with garbage disposals, you want to make sure that you empty that thing. I know a lot of garbage disposals say that they can take down certain huge chunks of food, but you don't intentionally want to throw full chunks of food down into your garbage disposal because your garbage disposal says it can handle it. Don't make it do any extra work than it has to, and make sure that you are regularly cleaning and deodorizing your garbage disposal as well. They sell the little things called Plink, I believe, and they are for cleaning your garbage disposal, but you can also do a baking soda and lemon juice wash to dump down there to clean it out and disinfect and deodorize it. So make sure that you're doing that regularly, as well as checking your garbage disposal before turning it on. The next tip I have is to wash your fruits and vegetables prior to eating them. I like to wash my fruits and vegetables when I get home from the grocery store. Fill up the sink with 4 cups of lukewarm water and then 1 cup of white distilled vinegar. Yes, I am telling you, this stuff is multi-purpose, ladies. So anyways, you're going to just put your vegetables in there and let them soak. You could also put it in a spray bottle and spray them on your veggies. Make sure the sink is cleaned and disinfected first, of course. Obviously, if it's something like lettuce, you don't want to let those soak in there, but I'm talking about apples and bananas and things with peelings. Apples, there might be that weird wax layer that they spray on there, so a really good trick to do to scrub that off is to take baking soda and use the baking soda to scrub that off. And then I go through and I still soak it in the vinegar just to make sure that I have everything off. Because even if something says it is organic, I still don't trust it enough to just eat it right off the shelf or right out of the bag. I will still go through these steps and wash it, because you don't know who was handling your fruits and vegetables when putting them on the shelf. You don't know who's growing them. So just make sure that you are cleaning off your fruits and vegetables properly. And if you can, do it right when you get home from the grocery store. The sooner the better. Next tip I have is to use rubber dish gloves to protect your hands and your nails. I currently do not have painted manicured fingers, but I do like to keep my nails and my hands safe from any hot water, because hot water strips your hands of oils, and I like to keep my nails nice and safe and pretty even when I have no polish on them. So I use rubber dish gloves. Not only do they protect my hands and my nails from getting the oils stripped off my hands, but I can also turn the water up hotter and not be scalded with hot water when washing my dishes. And you can get them from the dollar store or from Walmart. I prefer to get them from the dollar store because I can find them in a 2-pack at Dollar Tree, and they are just as good as the ones at Walmart or Target. Get yourself some dish gloves if you are worried about your nails and your hands. The next tip I have is to replace your kitchen towels regularly. I change my dish towels every single day. I replace the dish towel and the hand towel. You can find some really good deals on towels on Amazon, and you can also find some really cute ones at Dollar Tree. So make sure you pick up a bunch so that you are able to regularly change them out every single day, because you don't want to use a dish rag that you used yesterday on your dishes because germs and gross stuff. So make sure you're changing them out regularly. The next tip I have is to make sure that before you turn on your self-cleaning function on your oven, you are cleaning it out as best as you can before that. So here's a little story time. One time I turned on my oven without pre-cleaning it myself. I turned on my self-cleaning setting on my oven, and about 15 minutes later, I noticed that there was a huge flame inside of my oven, and the self-cleaning function locks your oven. So even if you turn off the self-cleaning function, it will still lock until the temperature drops. But I tried to open up my oven and I was like, oh my gosh, there's a flame in there. I don't know what to do. I was like, oh no, this thing is locked. I can't get this open. What am I gonna do? There's a flame in my oven. This could start a house fire. I looked it up on the internet and there was a bunch of people that said, oh, I did this too. This is why the self-cleaning function locks the oven, because if you were to open the oven, the flames would have expanded because oxygen and fire don't mix. It was laziness on my part, not cleaning out as much as I could beforehand. So they do sell oven cleaners that you can spray into your oven. If you do use one of those oven cleaners to pre-clean your oven instead of using something more natural like baking soda and vinegar, then make sure you are wearing a respirator mask, because there are chemicals in those cleaners that can make it very hard to breathe, and you don't want to be breathing in that stuff. So this is why I choose the natural pre-cleaning oven route, which is baking soda and my trusty vinegar. Make sure that you are pre-cleaning that oven before turning on your self-cleaning function. And that concludes the episode for today. I hope you all enjoyed these tips. I will see you next week with the next episode of the Homemaking for Dummies series. Don't forget to follow me on Instagram and follow me on Library, where you can earn cryptocurrency for watching videos and doing a bunch of other things on that site. It's pretty fun. So make sure that you are following me there as well. I am off to go and eat some lunch because I'm starving right now. I will see you next time. Bye-bye.